We have two presentations tonight, and it's great to have everybody here. It would take me a long time to thank everybody, but this has been an amazing collection of people to support this, bring the food, the organization they took, and of course it was easy because it had to do with Wade, but we are glad he's here. And if anybody can find Wade, we're still looking for him. I don't see anybody with overalls. Oh, he's sitting right here. Anyway, this is just a great gathering, and we're glad to have you. Chris is with Utopian Seeds. I'm going to let him introduce himself, listen to him for a while, and then at about 7 o'clock, we'll let Mr. Wade have the microphone. So thank you, everybody. Appreciate you coming.
My name's Chris Smith. I'm just going to spend about 30 minutes chatting with you tonight. I know most of you are here to see Wade, but hopefully I can share some of the interesting things that we're doing in Asheville. And my main aim of being here is to hopefully connect with some more people interested in seeds and seed saving and some of the work that we're doing. So I wanted to break down my 30 minutes into talking a little bit about okra, talking a little bit about collards. No one's groaned yet, it's good. And then I'll finish up just telling you a little bit about the Utopian Seed Project, which is a nonprofit I started about 3 or 4 years ago and has a focus on all these things that I'm hoping that you're going to be interested in. So collards, no, let's do okra first. Okra is really like my passion crop. And I don't know if anyone's picked up on the accent yet. I hope you have. I'm sounding more and more American every day. But I grew up in England and I came to America. Oh, sorry. I thought I found my first okra enthusiast, but no, just another Brit. So okra, so England, not much okra in England. I certainly didn't grow up eating okra. I don't really think I knew what okra was. It's very possible I came across okra in a curry. We have a large Indian population and there's a lot of curry, and India's big okra consumer. It's actually the world's largest okra producer. So I may have come across okra, but I didn't know about it until I came to America. And that was about 10 years ago, landed in Asheville and had a garden. And my very first garden that I started growing, I was all excited and I was phoning my mom and saying, hey, I can grow peanuts, I can grow sweet potatoes, I can grow okra. And they were like, what's okra? And it was just this really exciting adventure that I could grow all these things that my parents couldn't grow. And so I was kind of doing the whole jealousy thing and planted my entire garden. And everything was looking good in the beginning, and then I'm sure if there's gardeners in the room or farmers in the room, then this is like the hot, humid southeast, and there's pests and diseases and funguses, and pretty much everything in the garden succumbed to something, you know, like the squash and the downy mildew and the blights on the tomatoes, and then there's all these animals that you don't have in England, like groundhogs and raccoons. And the deer just seemed to be more aggressive. And everything got eaten in the garden apart from the okra. The okra was incredible. It grew so tall. The first house I rented in Asheville was kind of built into a hillside and had a balcony. And the balcony was kind of super high. And by the end of the season, I had to go on top of the balcony to harvest the okra. It was literally 12, 13 foot high and still producing. And so, as a kind of a naive English person in America, I was so, so enthused about okra. And I remember I was working for SoTrue Seed at the time, a local seed company. I remember going to all these ag conferences or even just telling my work colleagues and just being generally excited about okra. And at least half the people I spoke to were just like, okra, slimy, and just like totally shot me down. And I was like, it made me sad on the inside. Because I was just like, I was in this new love affair with this vegetable that I'd never heard of, but just grew so easily and so well. I began kind of getting more interested in okra and wanted to push back against this whole concept of like, ooh, okra's slimy. And so I started doing a little more research, and I felt like I started defending okra a little bit and getting a BM up on it and getting up on a soapbox and telling people why okra was so great. And the second, after people complaining that it was too slimy, the second complaint that I kept on running into, usually from home gardeners, was that it's too productive. And like, this is where I started like whacking my head against the wall, because I was like, you're literally complaining that this plant is too productive. I'm like, what is wrong with you people? It is so productive. that, like, just eat more okra or plant less okra, whatever, but you can't complain that the plant is too productive. That's just not fair. So pretty early on in this okra adventure, I started giving a presentation called In Defense of Okra. Actually, the first time I gave this presentation was at Organic Growers School, and I realized I kind of pitched them the idea, and they were like, yeah, that's a good idea. And then I realized that I couldn't just stand up for an hour and a half and tell them that okra was great. I had to have, like, I had to have something to actually talk about. So that kind of launched me down this big, deep research hole, and I started looking into, like, why is okra so great? It can't just be me saying it's great. And I didn't have to dig very deep to find out that okra is actually incredible, objectively, not just Chris subjectively. And so that led me to giving more presentations. I ended up writing a book about okra, and the my adventures with okra continue to this day. But some of the things that really stood out to me about okra is the entire plant is edible and or useful. And so I just want to quickly go through the plant for you just to share some of the stuff that you may not have come across. And I sometimes begin with this, but I was kind of nervous, so I didn't, like, how many people here actually like okra? I had kind of assumed that, but you know, no bottles have been thrown yet, so we're good. So okra, I'm sure most of you then have experienced eating the pods, and I, again, did not grow up in America, so I was not force-fed slimy okra, and I didn't develop a distaste for it. But I did grow all this okra, and I needed to know what to do with it. And yes, there's the southern ways to do, you know, the gumbos are delicious. I like fried okra. Okra and tomatoes are just a match made in heaven. Actually, every okra eating cuisine around the world has some version of okra and tomatoes, which just shows it's meant to be. But I started looking beyond the pod. And once you go beyond the pod, then that's where you start getting into some of the exciting stuff. Like, straight away, the leaves are edible. The leaves have a higher protein content than the pods and can be used basically as a cooked green, a very nutrient-dense cooked green. And then there's a related species to the normal okra that we eat called West African okra that actually has totally hairless leaves, and you can eat them raw as well. So the leaves, I think, have a good market potential. They're super delicious. I like cooking them up with a little bit of coconut cream, with some tilapia and turmeric spices, and kind of making a Thai Indian curry with the leaves. So pods, leaves, and then the flowers were the next thing we dug into. If you've grown okra, it's got this beautiful hibiscus-like flower, really, really glorious. It doesn't hold up for very long off the plant. Okra flowers actually only live for a single day. They open, pollinate, and then die within the same day. So if you're gonna cut them as a flower to give to a chef, then they'll be pretty disappointed because they'll be slimy within 24 hours. But if you take them and dry them, then they become a really great dried flower for teas. And we've had multiple tea companies now take up okra flowers and put it into their blends to make kind of like a vegetal savory tea, which is really delicious. And it's funny because on the back of all this stuff, as I began experimenting with these things, I kept on finding the research papers to back up the stuff I was doing in the field. And there's plenty of papers out there that look at the phytonutrient content of okra flowers and show that it's actually really, really good for you to be consuming these things. And so after I tried making a tea with it, the next natural step was to steep them in vodka just to see what happened. And the thing that blew my mind was okra flowers are mainly cream yellow colored, and they've got a tiny little bit of red around the base of the corolla. Once I put the okra flowers in the vodka, the whole liquid turned this like blood red, like really, really deep red color, which blew my mind. And once you've made okra flower vodka and you've realized it's bright red, you kind of have to make an okra flower vodka Bloody Mary because the colors just match really well. And we know that Bloody Marys have pickled okra on top, which is super exciting, but there's one thing missing is the straw. And so what you realize if you start really going deep down the rabbit hole of okra is that some varieties of okra have hollow petioles. The petiole is the part of the plant that connects the stalk to the leaf, that long stalk. And they're hollow, and you can chop them up into 6-inch strips if you want to and dry them down, and then they become straws. And so we're drinking our okra flower vodka Bloody Mary with pickled okra on top with an okra petiole straw, and that's how you know you've totally lost the plot. But the cool thing about the okra petiole straws is that even though they dry down and are totally shelf-stable, storable, when you start drinking through them, they rehydrate slightly. And when it rehydrates, then the mucilage that people generally don't like comes back. So you get a little bit of a slimy tip at the end of the straw. But the cool thing about the mucilage in okra plants is that it's been shown to be antimicrobial. So that straw that you can have in your Bloody Mary becomes shareable. So you can actually just buy one okra flour vodka Bloody Mary and share it with the whole table because of that antimicrobial straw. So great things can come from okra. So flowers, petioles, seeds. Okay, so seeds is where it gets really interesting for me. The seeds are kind of have a macronutrient profile fairly similar to like soybeans and some of the other big kind of commodity crops that we have. And I'm working with a few universities right now on some grants to try and get a much higher amount of okra into commodity acreage, because okra can be grown under conditions that are less intensive of externalized inputs, so you don't need as many pesticides, irrigation, fertilizers, all this sort of stuff. So okra can be grown more sustainably. And if we can show that okra seed has equal industrial market commodity applications to all these other things that can't be grown as sustainably, and we can get massive okra acreage into rotation, then we have like huge potential to literally change the environment that we're living in. And so actual applications of those seeds that I really enjoy working with are seeds as a flour, so kind of a gluten-free flour. You can roast them and grind them, and they take on this really intense, delicious nuttiness. This is something you can do on a home scale. You can just roast them in a dry pan and then grind them in a coffee grinder, and you have this really rich, delicious flour that you can mix into. I think of it as acorn flour. So I've made acorn flour pancakes. I've put it into quiche crusts, sweet potato pie crusts, and it just adds a real, real big dimension. And like with the leaves and the flowers, there's academic studies to back this up. There's a lot of work being done in Africa at the moment to use okra flour as a biofortification agent in breads to make them more have a wider nutritional content to fight malnutrition. And so we've worked with bakeries in Asheville that have made okra seed flour sourdough, okra seed flour savory muffins, and a whole host of other things can be done with this gluten-free flour. The seeds also have a reasonably high oil content, so you can press the seeds and get an edible oil out of it. There's one person in all of America doing this commercially, a guy called Clay Oliver out of just outside of Atlanta, Georgia. And the problem he ran into when he started pressing the oil is the percentage of the oil in the okra seed is just a little bit too low for efficient extraction. He had to literally upgrade his oil press with a heavier motor to actually be able to extract oil efficiently. And because he doesn't get very much oil per quantity of seed, he sells it for a lot of money. It's like $3 or $4 an ounce. So it's at present a high-end culinary oil, which while very tasty and all the top Southern chefs seem to really like it, isn't gonna become like a viable thing for you or I to buy today or tomorrow. But the project that we're working on, or another project that we're working on, is to do a breeding project to increase the oil seed content of that oil. One of the cool things with okra is the USDA has plant collections all over the country, and they house different varieties that they've collected from plant collecting trips all over the world. And they have over 1,000 accessions of okra, 1,000 unique strains of okra in the USDA collection. And we, as taxpayers, are allowed to go to that collection and request any of those seeds. And a lot of those seeds have been used in university studies, and so there are a lot of them have traits attached. And one study was done on the oilseed content of the seeds within the USDA collection, and you can see every single one of those 1,000 accessions has an oilseed content attached. And then you can do some little filtering and computer stuff and end up with a list of the top oilseed varieties that the USDA has and request them out. And we did this in 2021. We requested the top 20 varieties, grew them all together, did a whole bunch of hand pollination between the varieties to create crosses of high oilseed to high oilseed, with the hope that this basic breeding methodology of good and good makes better. And we're now 2 years further forward into it in planting out these hopeful strains of having higher oilseed varieties, and maybe in 2, 3, 4 years we'll be able to have an okra variety that has 30-35% oilseed content, and at that stage we could have a viable oilseed crop for the South, like specifically for the South, where you can grow okra as an oilseed crop, which I think would be pretty exciting. That's like most of the edible things, but the okra itself is part of the Malvaceae plant family, and most of the Malvaceae plant family has plants that have really awesome bast fibers. The bast fiber is the part of the plant between the bark and the central core. It's very, very, just a few millimeters wide, and those fibers are really, really strong. We can think of cotton and roselle and kanaf and jute. These are all Malvaceae family plants that have known fiber applications. And so okra has that same kind of plant genetics and plant heritage, and we can take the okra stalks at the end of the season and go through a retting process. I don't know if anyone's working with kind of like local fibers, but the retting process is just effectively to rot off the bark and leave the fibers exposed. And once you're left with those fibers, they've done tests on these fibers to show they've got a similar tensile strength to hemp. And there's a lot of talk about hemp right now, and lots of people are thinking about growing hemp as a fiber crop. But with okra, you can grow okra as a food crop, and at the end of the season, have a fiber crop as a byproduct. And that fiber can be turned into all the things that you can do with hemp, which on an industrial level can be clothing and actually everything. You can build tractors out of a hemp okra composite material. So you can build anything out of okra fiber. I've not started doing any of that yet, but we do extract the okra fiber every year, and you can make cordage and simple rope. Last year we went to the stage of taking that fiber, cleaning it up a little bit, and working with a local spinner, and we spun it into a yarn and ended up with a skein of okra fiber, effectively yarn. And then the next stage is to go from that and give it to a weaver, and then a weaver would be able to go like a full seed to cloth process with okra and effectively create okra fiber clothing. And I've been throwing this idea into the universe for quite a few years now, that one day I will turn up with like okra fiber clothing that somebody has made for me, because I don't have that skill set myself. So that's the whole plant. My book is called The Whole Okra, and the subtitle is A Seed to Stem Celebration, and it's literally a look at the fact that this plant that a lot of people write off as kind of like a southern novelty or something that's just a slimy pod actually has like massive and expansive potential within our food and farming system. And so everyone put their hand up, so you all already like okra, or at least most of you do. Someone at the back really likes okra. And but I think okra has more to offer us, and I hope you think about expanding the way you think about okra. So that was my okra spiel. I'm gonna shift gears into collards, and then we'll finish with just a little bit about the Utopian Sea Project. I've been working with okra as long as I've been in America, so about 10 years. More recently, maybe about halfway through my okra journey, I got involved with a project called the Heirloom Collard Project. And I think the Heirloom Collard Project is an awesome example of some of the work that you guys may be doing in your community, but also a reflection of work that is being done in communities across the country. The short piece with the Heirloom Collard Project is that basically in the early 2000s, there was a brassica geneticist, Dr. Mark Farnham, who was kind of like, oh my God, there's no diversity in collards. He just woke up one day and was like, ah, we've got loads of cabbages, we've got loads of broccoli, we don't have any genetic diversity in collards. And he, you know, works for the USDA and has access to this big, all these accessions that I've talked about with okra and all these other things. And he looked at it and he was like, there's literally no collards in this collection. And all these plant breeders and university types, they use this collection to pull broad genetic diversity into their breeding projects. And at the time, and actually ongoing issues with black rot in brassicas and breeding collards that were more disease resistant, they didn't have any genetic reservoirs to draw upon. So he got together with a few other folks and they got a grant and they did a Southeast plant collecting trip. And basically two guys drove all over the Southeast, and whenever they saw a patch of collards growing, they just pulled up when it knocked on the door and was like, hey, I like your collards. And they were like, oh, that's nice, who are you? And then they had a conversation. The collards generally were like a unique backyard collection that these people had just been growing and saving. There were a few instances where they were like, oh yeah, I just got these seeds from the feed and seed store down the road, and they kind of skipped over those ones. But on the whole, they kept on discovering these unique populations of collards growing in people's back gardens, and those people were really willing to share seeds back to these researchers. And so they traveled over, I think they covered about 9 states over a number of years and collected a whole bunch of collards, which then got boarded onto the USDA collection. And there's a few kind of interesting things to note with this whole thing. One is most of the seed savers were, I think the average age was about 70, and a majority of them reported that they didn't have anyone to pass their collared varieties onto. They were fully expecting that when they died, the seeds would die with them. So that's pretty sad, especially because this was 20 years ago. So we can assume that a majority of these people that were stewarding these varieties for multiple generations, for some of them, like, were gonna hit a dead end. And may already be dead, or likely to already be dead. And so on one hand, these researchers have done this incredible preservation mission where they've driven around and they've collected these seeds and they've preserved these seeds. They're in the USDA. You can go to the USDA website right now and look them up and you'll see these varieties. And so that is a good thing. That seed preservation is a good thing, and I know a lot of people in the room are engaged in seed preservation. But the interesting thing for me that I think I've experienced with this project is that these researchers preserved the seeds, put them in the USDA as an institution that would continue to preserve the seeds, and that was kind of the end of the story. And to me, I think there's a massive missing piece here where it almost feels like the seeds were saved and the people were forgotten, or even not the people, the communities that saved those seeds were forgotten. Because those community seed keepers that were doing that work to save the seeds, they hadn't been doing that for glory or for recognition. None of these varieties will be found in any of the agricultural texts of the 18 and 1900s. They didn't make it into seed catalogs. Most of them didn't have names. In the USDA, most of them are named for the people that gave them to them or for the towns that they came from. So they were just being saved because that's what people did. They saved seeds so they could grow more food next year, so they could save seeds and grow more food next year. And so that system, that culture, the communities that save the seeds, I think they're what we should save, and then the seeds come on the back of that. But the USDA mentality has been to save the seeds, and actually most institutional seed saving over the last couple of hundred years has been, let's preserve the seeds and forget about the people to some extent. And so for about 15 years, these seeds just sat in the USDA collection. And yes, probably some university researchers did some breeding work with them, and they may have been referenced in some academic papers. But those seeds had evolved within those communities and then been taken from the communities without any effort to reintroduce them to the communities. And so the Heirloom Collar Project, about 5 years ago, got started up by Ira Wallace, who some of you might know from Southern Exposure Seed Exchange. And she just kind of chanced upon this project when she was down in Charleston and saw a USDA trial site of all these varieties. And she was just blown away by the diversity. Because it's not just that these were 60 varieties of collards. It's that each of these collard varieties were unique and distinct. And there were frilly ones and colorful ones and blue ones and purple ones and white veined ones and heading cabbage collards and loose leaf collards and top bunch collards. There was just like so much difference within all these different collar varieties. And Ara Wallace, who you know is now in her mid-70s and has been growing and saving seeds for decades, was just astounded by this diversity. And so if Ara was astounded by that diversity, then you can believe that it was truly astounding. And she basically in that field was like, we've got to do something to get these seeds back to the people. And that's when the Heirloom Collar Project kind of launched. So the Heirloom Collar Project, in summary, is a project, it's a broad group of collaborators across the whole country that are slowly pulling seeds out of the USDA, back out of the institutions, and kind of reverse engineering that path so that we can get these seeds regenerated, regrown to a scale where they can be put back into the hands of people that have deep connections to collards. And so many of them came from North Carolina that were working closely within these communities to get these collards regrown and redistributed. And then teaching about education, culture, history, as well as basic seed-saving skills so that more people can grow and experience this beautiful diversity. So that's kind of the Heirloom Collar Project in a nutshell. And I think it's just it's a beautiful example of the work that's being done in communities, the damage that can be done by institutional seed preservation, and then kind of like the pushback that we can give to like get those seeds back into the people that they're really meaningful to. And there's a lot of this kind of work beginning to happen within the seed saving communities. And so there are two projects that we're working on, and I'm going to bring that back to the Utopian Sea Project and kind of just give you a very brief overview of what we're working on. Because the Utopian Sea Project aims to be both practical in the ground, seed saving, seed preservation, seed breeding, seed trialing, and at the same time it's trying to be visionary in that we really want to shift the food system to embrace much more diversity than it currently represents. It's always sad to me when I walk into a supermarket and see just like one variety of okra, if I see okra at all, or one variety of collards, when I know how many hundreds of varieties actually exist. So we're working as a nonprofit to, we're working with farmers, we're working with seed companies, we're working with chefs and added value food businesses and consumers to try and highlight this diversity that exists. And one of the main reasons we're working with diversity isn't just because the food system could be more delicious and beautiful and interesting, it can be all of those things, but with a broader genetic diversity within our food system, then we can show that that food system is more resilient to external shocks. And if we've learned anything over the last couple of years, we know that supply chain shocks, rising fertilizer costs, climate change, extreme weather events, all of these things are making it harder to grow food in any region. And if we're working with a very narrow set of genetics or crop types or varieties within our food system, then that food system is really, really vulnerable to those shocks. But if we can introduce really like expansive genetic diversity in terms of loads of different varieties and loads of different crops within those systems, then we inherently have a food system that is more resilient to all of those shocks. And that translates to greater food security for all of us, which is like the core mission of the Utopian Sea Project. We put out a collard magazine recently, and I brought some copies if anyone's interested in purchasing one, and I brought some copies of my book if anyone's interested in one of those. So thank you so much.